This podcast is brought to you by LMU Munich.
For invitation, and thank you very much for the better room here. And so in this, I have three lectures about entanglement entropy. And today, I'm going to talk about entanglement entropy in quantum field theory or quantum minimal system without using any AdS CFT. But my second and third lecture is using AdS CFT, and I will show how to compute entanglement entropy and also some brief summary of recent progress about this subject. So my title of my lectures are entanglement entropy. Entanglement entropy and AdS CFT holography. So, as already I wrote it here, so the basic review articles in this subject is summarized here. So this first one is about the EE means just entanglement entropy. It's a long word, so I just summarize, I shorten this way. And EE in quantum field theory, now there are several nice review articles. Also entanglement entropy in some condensed matter context, there are a lot more, but I just recommend one of them. Well, it's quite theoretical literature where people show how this basic property called area law works in this quantum minimal system. And this holographic calculation, this AdS CFT calculation, we wrote a few review articles. And finally, if we're interested in more deep aspects of quantum information theory, which is right behind of this entanglement entropy, is you can look at the famous Preskill's lecture note or some textbook written by Nielsen and Chuan. These are basic literatures. So I just first write down some contents of this talk. This contents of three lectures. So today I'm going to talk about part one, which is entanglement entropy in quantum field theory. So but first I will explain the definition and basic aspects of entanglement entropy. So basics of entanglement entropy, so definition and properties. And then I'm going to talk about quantum field theory, so entanglement entropy in quantum field theory, and give some basic properties such as area laws and so on. And finally, I will show some explicit calculation of entanglement entropy, especially in theory, which is conformally bound, conformal field theory. But also, we have one more restriction, which is two dimension, the simplest conformal field theory, which is 2D conformal field theory. In higher dimensions, calculation gets higher in general. So I just quickly mention in later my talk, but here I'm going to focus on two-dimensional conformal field theory. And part two, which will be my second and third lecture, I'm going to talk about holographic entanglement entropy, which means just calculation of this quantity called entanglement entropy in AdS CFT. And first, I give the idea of holographic entanglement entropy. And then I will show some basic example, which is AdS3, lowest dimensional example. And six, I will give some derivation, recent derivation. Of this entanglement calculation of holographic entanglement entropy. And discuss some higher dimensional examples. And finally, I want to mention some recent progresses, some recent developments, recent topic. I'm not sure how much I can spend for this subject, but if I have time, I'd like to give some several or just one topics about holographic entanglement entropy. So if you have any request about this, especially final part, maybe just tell me some ideas. But the other part is quite standard. I just give some quantum field theory calculation and give also explain the AdS CFT calculations. Okay, so let me go on to the content. Part number one, which is a basic aspect of entanglement entropy. Basics. First, I have to define what is this entanglement entropy. I just cut it here. So this is actually a very simple concept that in quantum systems, so we consider some quantum mechanics with a multiple degree of freedom, and we divide the system into two parts. Divide a quantum system. We have some quantum system. Any quantum system is fine. And we have this, we divide this quantum system into two parts, which are like it A and B. So A is one of some subset of this system, and B is the other part of that whole system. So more precisely, so we have some description in terms of Hilbert space, which is standard in quantum mechanics. We have total Hilbert space, which describes some system, and we just factorize this total Hilbert space into two parts. This way, HA and HB, and HA is a Hilbert space for this system called A, and the other space system is called B, which is B. So often we call this this A the subsystem A in this context. So we first factorize this Hilbert space, and basic example is some spin system, for example, spin chain. So you can just have several spins extended to one direction, for example, a spin chain, or you can consider higher dimensional version of this. We have some spins, which is aligned. So we just cut it out. So we have spin, this up or down, which I don't know. You just artificially cut some part. You can cut here, or you can cut here. But still, they are interacting in the usual, for example, in Ising model or something like that. So we have some interaction there. But just artificially, we just say, we just call this part is A, and the other part is B. Then automatically we have this decomposition, direct product structure of this Hilbert space. But you can choose any different, you can just call this as A and so on. There are lots of different choice of this A and B. So then this is quantum mechanics. The basic quantity is a density matrix. Especially if you look at the pure state, this is actually reduced to wave function. But we write it raw total density matrix. So density matrix for total system. Density matrix for total system. So especially if you are considering pure state, which means that this density matrix just written in terms of single wave function, typically at zero temperature, this is a ground state of the function, or some thermal state. You can consider some thermal state. Then if we assume canonical ensemble, so you get beta H. This H is Hamiltonian, and divided by partition function, which is just trace of this guy. So this is a familiar example, but there are many other situations if we don't assume any thermodynamical cube, then we have a more complicated version of this. So anyway, so this is so we define this density matrix for total system, which describes this quantum mechanics of this theory. So we would like to define some other density matrix, which is called reduced density matrix for region A. So this is a density matrix for which acts only for this HA. So total density matrix acts for this Hilbert space. So this we have matrix here, we have index here. So this index takes this vector space. But now we define this low A. This is a crucial point of this definition, and this is very simple. We start with this total density matrix. We just trace out this Hilbert space B. So this is a smaller size matrix. So we somehow get rid of some important information, which is important information for this region B. So in that sense, we have some coarse-grained density matrix. And that means we lose some information. So this this amount of loft information is measured by entropy. So more precisely, this von Neumann entropy. This loft information is measured by this entropy. So which is written in this familiar form of von Neumann entropy. So minus trace rho log rho. Of course, rho log rho, rho is a less than, this is a probability, so less than 1. So log rho is negative. So we need a minus sign. So this is a definition of this entropy called entanglement entropy. So this is a quantity which we work with in this talk, and this is a entanglement entropy which we can shortly call it EE. So okay, so I'd like to also give some basic example of how to, and the computation of this entanglement entropy, which is just two spin systems. So, well, this is called 2 qubits. So we have some two spin, which is so we have two spin, A, B, and just go two electrons, which has some spin half. So there are, for example, we can consider one state, one pure state, which is given by the following wave function. So assuming that this region, this A spins up and B spin is down. Just this. It's a very simple state. And in this case, if we compute reduce the density matrix, just tracing over B for this total density matrix just given by this one for this pure state, then we get a very simple result that we just have A is just always up. Very simple result. So in the matrix language, this is just 1, 0, 0, 0, eigenvalue just 1, 0. And it is almost clear that this quantity, this entropy becomes 0. Just 1 or 0, it becomes 0. On the other hand, there are another example which becomes not trivial. So I can write it here. So another example, this is a first example. And second one. So in this case, there are no entropy. In this case, we say this is not entangled. There are no entanglement. So this entropy measures amount of entanglement, which means a roughly correlation between these two guys. And even if we assume that we measured some spin A, B, we measure spin B, but still the result doesn't tell anything about A. This is originally just only up. There are only probability, which means that this A spin is up. So there are no direct correlation between them. But second one is the opposite case, which is like singlet state. So this A spins up. When A spins up, it's always B spins down. And when A spins down, then B spins always up. So in this case, we can do the same calculation. And we can do this. Then we just trace out this one, the B. And as we can easily see, there are two possibilities. And indeed, the answer is very easy to find, that A spins up. This is one possibility, and the other one is a
Oh, down. Both are down.
So that means in the matrix language, it's the eigenvalue is the same, two eigenvalues which are the 1/2. In this case, we can compute this entanglement entropy again. So we have two contributions which are 1/2, 1/2 here. So that means this 1/2 cancels out, so we get log 2. So in this case, there are non-zero entanglement. In other words, if we assume we observe that spin B, B spins down, then it is all, this exactly tells us that always spin for A is always up. And the opposite thing is also true. So if we have information for this B spin, then we know the information about A. So in this, they are entangled with each other. And indeed, you can show this is a maximal entanglement. So this is a maximal entanglement. So these two examples are really basic example of this quantum entanglement, quantum information theory. Maybe many of you already heard in some other lectures. So, but anyway, what we'd like to do is to promote this kind of calculation into much more complicated system like quantum minimum system, which has an infinite degree of freedom, or maybe some also quantum field theory, which has a really literally continuum limit, and it's really infinite many degree of freedom. So anyway, so this entanglement entropy SA, one interpretation is the amount of information for B. Amount of information assuming that this the subsystem B is not visible to some observer. So if we assume this, so you can look at this definition that here we trace out this Hilbert space of B. That means we are assuming that we are only do observation which is related to this subsystem A, and we forget about the information B, and then we find this ambiguity which is measured by this Hondonima entropy. So this ambiguity is literally amount of information which is lost by assuming that the subsystem B is not visible. So this is a quite elementary thing, but some of us may wonder what's the relation to standard entropy, thermodynamical entropy. I just want to mention this. This is quite standard. So this is a relation to thermal entropy. But anyway, what I'd like to say in the end is that this entanglement entropy is more general concept than standard thermodynamical entropy. So standard thermodynamical entropy, we can just consider standard canonical distribution, which I already mentioned previously. So we have this density matrix, and we can just compute. So we can just compute the entropy for this. S rho, which is just Hondonima entropy, rho log rho. And we just plug this expression here. And then we find 1 over z here. And we have some trace, and we have this exponential beta h. And some log rho, which is like minus beta h minus log z. This expression we find, and we can just treat each of this is the average of Hamiltonian, so this should be just energy. So we find like just beta times energy here. So this is a wave factor, and we talk about this one, but log z we know, which is like minus beta f is a free energy. So this sign cancels out, we have minus sign here. So in the end, we find this for Neumann entropy, it's beta times E minus F. E is the energy, and F is the free energy. So this is some, we know this well-known formula, which is F equal E minus TS. I need this gives S entropy, which is standard thermodynamical entropy. So this confirms that this von Neumann entropy for canonical ensemble just reproduces what we know about thermodynamical entropy. But we are, in this entanglement entropy calculation, we are using rho A, which is no longer same as this canonical ensemble or nor this pure state. It's more general mixed state. Then we compute this entropy, so the result should be much more general than the standard thermodynamical entropy. Okay, so these are a basic definition of entanglement entropy and the basic examples. So any questions? This explanation is clear? Okay. So okay, now I move to the properties, basic properties of this entanglement entropy. So, yes. Okay, so let's talk about properties. There are two properties which I'd like to tell you here. It's one property is a very simple one. So let's assume that the total density matrix is pure, which means you can write in terms of wave function. Then we can immediately show that this following relation is true. So SA, we compute entanglement entropy for region A. So we have, this is a total system, and this region A is somehow this kind, this subsystem here. And the subsystem B is a complement of this, and A plus B is a total system. So in this setup, we can just show that this SA equal to SB. So if you have in mind some thermodynamical entropy, this is rather strange. This is rather strange behavior because if we assume that this region is expanding, we expand this region B. That means this region B shrinks. Region A expands and region B shrinks. But still, this equality holds. So this means that this entropy is not extensive. It's nothing proportional to the volume of region A. Rather, much more different quantity. Not extensive. But this is very basic. And if you are interested in proof, actually, this is equivalent to the statement of Schmidt deconformation, which you learn probably in linear algebra course. So Schmidt deconformation simply just tells us that any vector is between the some linear combination with particular weight with the eigenvalue and some A and B, some basis, some orthonormal basis of this in A and B. And this N is always smaller than minimum of Hilbert, dimension of Hilbert space for A and dimension of Hilbert space for B. So if we assume this, then it is obvious that we get this relation, right? So this entropy is just SA equal SB, is just sum of each lambda, lambda I and log lambda I. It is immediate that this group is the same. Or you can just go back to the definition of this von Neumann entropy and you can directly show this. This is quite elementary property. So, but also before I go on, I would like to mention what happens if we consider some thermodynamical, sorry.
thermodynamical entropy. So if it's not pure, it's mixed state, if the total density matrix mixed, then generically you find these two guys the same, not same. And especially when rho dot is summer, and it comes from some canonical ensemble, then what we can show is that we can take limit so that this now slightly we can use this setup, and we assume that A goes to shrink to zero size. A is some finite size originally, but take the limit A goes to zero, and essentially that means B covers whole space. So if we assume B goes to zero and take this difference SB minus SA, then in express example, you can confirm that this gives thermodynamical entropy. Yeah, of course, this is intuitively obvious because A goes to just empty set and B covers everything. So that should be true from this previous argument. But the thing that we have to be careful is that SA is get divergent, as we will come back later, but this has a divergence called area of divergence. And we have to somehow cancel this divergence. And so this small size limit of A is a bit subtle, so we need to subtract this. And as already also confirmed here, so SA equals SB for pure state. For pure state, this of course always zero. That means there are no thermodynamical entropy that is consistent with what we know. But in generally, so we can take this limit, and this is a precise connection to thermodynamical entropy.
Okay.
And so now, okay, so now I'd like to come to the second property, which is called strong subadditivity. And this is again long one, so you just write SSA, strong subadditivity. So this is summarized following inequality. So we assume Hilbert space is like this, HA. So here we implicitly assume that Hilbert space is HA times HB. But here we have a multiple separation. So we have HA, HB, and HC. And you can also tensor some more if we want. So these are arbitrary, but just we are focused on this ABC. And we have some total density matrix for this total Hilbert space. And we don't care whether this is mixed state or pure set. Both are okay for the following argument. So the strong subadditivity tells us the following inequality. So we have ABC, and we consider the union of set A and A plus B plus S B plus C. We combine these two, and this sum is always greater than the another one, which is A plus B plus C and SB. So this inequality can be exactly shown in a quantum minimal system. In quantum, we are using complicated Hilbert space linear algebra, but this is completely proven by Lipp and Ruskai, and this is called strong subadditivity. So this is not equality, but inequality. So some sort of analog of second law of thermodynamics, but nothing, there are no direct relation to the second law of thermodynamics, but some other.
The total system has to be a pure state or anything?
Any, it's fine. Yeah, so we can tensor anything. If we trace out this region, then you get mixed state. So I'd like to add some explanation of this. So I don't derive this in literally, but it is very easy to derive this inequality by holographic
calculation. Also, here, I'd like to give some intuitive understanding of this. So the, what this inequality tells us. So if we naively just replace this A and B, ABC is just number. So this is the original really abstract set. But just naively say this is number. So we find this kind of inequality. And just we call this x and y. And we assume these two guys are the same. So then we have x plus y over 2, and this x plus y over 2. So if we sum up this, then we have the same one. So we can parameterize this way as a particular case. Then we find that this function, it just tells us that x plus y. This inequality we are very familiar with. This is just says that this function is concave function. Second derivative is negative for zero. Right, so this is the middle point. And so it's much larger than this point. So this. So strong subadditivity is just simply summarized as this concave property of this entropy function. But of course, this is a slightly more abstract thing because A and B is not actually number. So these two properties are basic property of this entanglement entropy, which sometimes we use later. And eventually, we want to promote this in some quantum field theory. But before that, I would like to quickly mention some motivation why we consider this entanglement entropy, especially from condensed matter viewpoint. So applications. So I think I'll hear also about this from Joe's talk, Joe's lecture later, but let's give some brief introduction of that. So first of all, this if we talk about much more degree of freedom, so if we talk about quantum animal system rather than just two spin systems, so this entanglement entropy is describes some degree of freedom of the quantum animal systems. And this is because this entanglement entropy is roughly speaking, this is obvious from the definition, is this is the effective log of, we take log, but the effective rank of this matrix, row A, reduced density matrix. So this measures amount of quantum degree of freedom. Them. And for example, this is a powerful method to compute many property of ground state of quantum numerical system, such as central charge or topological entropy or something like that. But I'm not going to mention detail. But at least in a numerical approach to this condensed matter system, we have to put this spin system on a lattice and assume that size of lattice is finite. And that means we somehow approximate this matrix row A by some finite size matrix. So that means if this effective rank of matrix is so huge, then it's quite difficult to do any numerical calculation by using computers. But if this effective rank somehow turns out to be very small, we can somehow compress the quantum information. And so that we can compute numerical. So roughly this measures so how much we can compress the quantum information. So this gives some effective tool to measure the difficulty of this computer calculations. So especially when S gets larger, so then numerical approach is quite difficult. So when entanglement, if we compute entanglement, entropy and turns out to be quite large, then that means it's quite difficult. There are lots of quantum fluctuations, and it's computer calculation is quite hard. But in a typically, this kind of situation appears when we talk about quantum critical point or some fixed point where we can approximate the theory in some conformal field theory or gap theory, as a gapless theory. So this gets divergent. Point. So one typical example of this kind of divergence appears is some phase transition, second order phase transition. And one very famous example is Isaac model. I just quickly sketch this. So in this context, this entanglement entropy can be regarded as a quantum order parameter to probe some phase transition. So, for example, this Ensing spin chain with some transverse magnetic field. So, Hamiltonian is just simply sigma is a spin in z direction, we just z, and n is each side. And we the nearest neighbor interaction. And we have some magnetic fields which couples in x direction. We have x direction magnetic field which couples the spin, sigma spin. And then what people compute this entanglement entropy and find that there is some clear transition. So we assume some particular subsystem and we change this magnetic field. And when magnetic field is very small, then we have some standardizing model. So we have some up-down degeneracy, which means log 2. We have log 2. But if we assume H is very large, then this ferromagnetic ground state is completely broken down. And just we have paramagnetic ground state, which means entropy goes to 0. Then no degeneracy. So we have this. But in the middle, there is a particular point, which is H is equal to 1. And there is some phase transition between these two phases, this ferromagnetic phase and the paramagnetic phase. And if we compute this, you find that this is divergent. This entropy gets divergent at this critical point, what we also roughly summarize here. So this divergent is, there is some scaling rule, law, over this divergence is related to central charge at this fixed point. Central charge for easing spin change becomes 1/2. In this example, but in general, we have this kind of scaling rule. And Cushy is a correlation length. Correlation length gets divergent at this fixed point. And so there is this kind of behavior. And you can confirm that indeed, when quantum critical point happens, then this quantum fluctuation gets large. So these are basic. So I explained basic examples until now. And I now would like to move on to this more particle physics-like quantum field theory analysis of entanglement entropy. So any question so far?
What is the
AU? You can just choose some interval with finite length. And this value doesn't depend on this. This result is universal in that. That's a good question. Yeah, I think people work out when this is saturated, but it's quite complicated. Result is complicated, but work out recent paper in quantum. So I cannot easily, summarize the result, but Even if you set this as equal, there you can derive actually another independent inequality called Winter-Linden inequality, which is actually claimed to be independent from strong subadditivity, and gives another example of this property of entanglement. So it's a quite richer, there are richer story. So now we consider entanglement entropy quantum theory. And important property which I'd like to tell here is the area law, something called area. So definition of entanglement entropy is already we explained, and we can just simply extend this entanglement entropy in quantum theory in the following way. So already somehow I showed this picture. We just have some time slice, t equal some particular time. And in quantum field theory, as we know, Hilbert space is a field configuration at fixed time. So if we have fixed time, you have some wave function. But actually, this becomes a wave functional. And this wave functional is completely fixed by this this wave. So wave function now is like, take this form, some field configuration phi, which is a field configuration at t equal t0. So we'd like to do this total Hilbert space is factorized into HA times HB. So we have like this kind of division. Just for my interest, I just put it A and B. So you can choose any boundary of this region A or B. And if you fix this boundary, you can completely separate the total system into A and B. And at the same time, so this is we assume some time slice, and we divide it to two parts. We automatically factorize this Hilbert space. So now we can simply define this entanglement entropy in the previous definition, using this previous definition. But there are some problems about quantum field theory, because quantum field theory includes infinitely many degrees of freedom. So we have to somehow treat them. So this is called area law. So there are infinitely many degrees and so because of that entanglement entropy is usually gets divergent in quantum theory. So, but there are some basic rule about this divergence, and this is called area law. So area law is summarized following way. So we consider, so this is my convention, d plus 1 dimensional. So 1 is the time, and d is the space dimension. So in condensed matter literature, people usually call this a d-dimensional system, but in particular, it is a d plus 1 dimensional system. So we have d plus 1 dimensional quantum field theory. And with, so assumption is this one, with some relativistic fixed point, UV fixed point. We are not talking about infrared, but we assume that relativistic UV fixed point. So this is the assumption. If the theory is asymptotically free, often we have this property in particle physics. So, and this is also true, of course, trivial example, free massless scalar field theory is already always it in a fixed point, complete gapless theory. But in this case, what there is some basic rule that so this entanglement entropy scales leading divergence. This we are talking divergence, and we are looking at divergence, leading divergence, which is some constant. This is some model-dependent constant, but doesn't depend on the choice of region A. So it's like this form. So this area appears
an area of boundary of A.
So not the volume, but it's the area of this boundary,
and divided by some cutoff scale, epsilon. And there are some, of course, subleading divergent piece, but that's a much smaller. But in general, D minus 2 or 3. So we have in mind this setup. We have this, and there is a boundary here, this partial A, which are, and the result is proportional to the area of this boundary. So you can, of course, modify this result, but still you get result is proportional to this area. And this epsilon is a cutoff. This is a UV cutoff. But this is a cutoff, not in energy scale, but the length scale. So continuum limit is epsilon goes to zero. So in that sense, lattice constant, sort of analog of lattice constant. So we take continuum limit, we take epsilon goes to zero. So the intuitive reason why we find this area rho is simply just because if we are talking about the entanglement, which is correlation, quantum correlation, and correlation gets very becomes very enhanced and very large when we these 2 points come to get closer, right? So these 2 points is very correlated very strongly, but this separated as a far from there, then these two guys are not entangled. But of course, we have to worry about the case where interaction is long range, and so on. But this result is even true for massless theory, gapless theory, for conformal field theory, except D equal 1, which I mentioned. There are some exceptions which we have to. Talk about. So, first one is, as already mentioned, D equal 1, lowest dimensional case. D equal 1 is 1 plus 1 dimensional quantum field theory, but I'm talking about CFT, conformal field theory, massless quantum field theory, and with scale invariance. So we are talking about two-dimensional conformal field theory. This is a very special example which somehow violates this result. If we naively set D equal 1, this becomes 0, power is 0. That means just constant. And this is true for mass-gapped, massive 2D CFT, 2D quantum field theory. But in 2D CFT, this epsilon to 0 should be interpreted as logarithmic divergence. This is a bit subtle thing. If we take epsilon goes to 0 limit, D goes to 1 limit, yeah. So in this case, we know the result. This actually I will derive later, but just write the result. It's logarithmically divergent. We have log epsilon here. And L is the size of subsystem. We are talking about situation where theory is defined infinitely extended line, and subsystem is a finite interval with L. So we have some logarithmic violation. And second example is often emphasized in condensed matter literature is a Fermi surface, quantum field theory. This is a bit sometimes confusing, but I just But here again, we have some logarithmic contribution, but this is true in any dimension. And we assume, as is natural in condensed matter systems, this Fermi. So this is a Fermi surface. We have fermion which, occupies the energy levels up to some energy level, which we call Fermi energy, which is kF or mu F or of order the scale. So we assume this scale is epsilon, is a UV cutoff scale, which is quite high. So quite high, this energy, which is not, usual, I think, in condensed matter physics, but not so usual in particle physics. But if we assume this, then we find this entanglement entropy logarithmically violates this area law. So the result is like this. But to understand, we don't talk about coefficient. In particular theory, you can compute coefficient, but I don't just, it's more details, I just don't mention that. But the origin of this logarithmic divergence is actually exactly the same as this one. So actually, this result roughly can be derived from this first one. This is because we have some dispersion relation of energy and some momentum. And this Fermi surface means we have fermions which occupy the energy level from here to some point. And we talk about lowest energy excitation, which is some ripples on this Fermi surface, and which is actually approximate. We are approximated by this linear dispersion relation at this point. So originally it is parabolic maybe, but at this point it's just approximated by linear dispersion relation. So in that sense, it's proportional to. So we talk about this parallel direction. So energy excitation is proportional to perpendicular, but we are talking about other direction, it is square, it's non-relativistic. We can, for small energy excitation, we can forget about this, basically. So in that sense, actually, theory is reduced. This is very roughly, I'm lacking speaking, but Fermi surface physics, in, for example, d plus 1 time on this dimension, then we have some sum over 2D CFT with some transverse momentum. And transverse momentum is d minus 1 dimension. So we have this direction, one radial direction. So space dimension is d, so one radial direction, and the other transverse direction d minus 1. So that gives this contribution. Right? So each point, and this is the lattice point, so we have density is epsilon, so we have this factor. And logarithmic part comes from this. For each sector, it becomes 2D CFT. So we just multiply this factor. So this is quite a rough explanation. But if we don't assume this, I mean, highly energetic Fermi surface and just talk about finite energy Fermi surface, then this contribution actually modified into finite correction. So delta SA is originally satisfied area law, and that is still the same. But this KF, energy, Fermi energy is finite, so we have this finite contribution. Anyway, so these are some exceptions, yes? Sorry, that's this one?
The last line.
Yeah. Okay, so we have some Fermi surface here, Fermi surface. And for each point, we are talking about some lowest energy excitation. So we are taking into account this radial momentum excitation, which is proportional to the energy, so it's a linear dispersion relation. But if we can also excite this region, but this becomes independent sector. So this transverse direction becomes independent with each other, and you can excite individually. So you can approximate.
Mm.
Sorry?
Each of those little patches that you drew
enter
into that product.
Right. That's a low energy approximation. And these CFTs doesn't talk to each other at a zero order approximation. But I should say this is quite a rough argument. And we should have some. If you are interested more, you can look at the more sophisticated argument. Okay, so now I finished the basic property of entanglement entropy in quantum field theory. And I would like to move on to the calculation of this entanglement entropy in quantum field theory. So are there any other question, comments? Yes?
But I was wondering, in principle, one doesn't have to do this separately. If you have a time-dependent wave function, you don't have to consider just the time slice, or do you? Or would that be an interesting question?
Sorry, you're talking about a time-dependent situation?
Yeah.
Right? But always, this entanglement entropy is defined in terms of von Neumann entropy, which may be some time-dependent.
Right.
So we can just always fix some time, and the result depends on the choice of time. Yeah, we need time. And we assume that space-time is just flat space-time. So there's a natural time slice. We are not talking about entanglement entropy in curved space-time here. In curved space, of course, result depends. I mean, we have to be careful about choice of time slice. But still, even in that case, we can, for example,
talk about this region A is here, but you can choose the other, some complicated time slice here. Mm-hmm. But you can show these two guys that give the same result. Because Hilbert space division is the same.
Okay, so let me go. So, okay.
So first,
so this is actually true for any usual calculation of entanglement entropy in quantum field theory. We use a method so-called replica.
Method or replica trick. So this is I'd like to explain first.
So, but this original comes from this basic, very simple observation. So anyway, we want to compute this law of rho, which looks a bit tough because this involves some rho. So, but we can rewrite this in the following way. So we can just first consider some derivative of n and some artificial parameter at this point. So we consider rho a to n's power. And we take derivative of n, then we get the log rho, and if we set n equal 1. So this is a, this kind of calculation is called replicatoric. But a more deep reason will be become later, important later. So, okay, so now we can use the fact that rho A, trace rho A equal to 1. So this normalizer, we can just rewrite this into more convenient form. This is almost trivial, but this log of this one. You can take derivative log, but you get 1 over trace rho A, but which is always 1, normalized to be 1. So we don't care. So this is the most useful expression. So, but how can we use this to compute its entanglement entropy? This is the next thing I'd like to explain. Well, of course, I mean, so you can just look at this quantity rather than take derivative of this limit. So this is closely related to the entropy called Lange entropy, which also people discussing. But that entropy is much more difficult to computing, especially from AdS CFT viewpoint, so I'm not going to mention it. So in this paper, in this talk, I'm always working with this n equal 1 limit, which is entanglement. But certainly this entanglement entropy is not the only possible entropy, but there are other kinds of entropy which carries another information. So that's also interesting to look at. So we consider some 2D CFT, some of QFT. I consider the ground state. Oh, 2D. Maybe you can also generalize as quantum field theory. So we just write QFT, but in the end, I'm going to assume that we are talking about 2D conformal field theory. But just assume this 2D conformal field theory. So then we use some passing integral form. Then we can express this wave function or this state is in terms of passing integral from minus infinity to some time, but with some time we are talking about time independent situation, so we can always set time slice equal t equals 0. And we pass integral from minus infinity. But here we implicitly assume this time is Euclidean time, Euclidean, which is some Euclidean analytical combination. This time is, so t goes to minus infinity means that we project any state by this some large time times Hamiltonian. So if t is very large, infinite, then this completely, this procedure completely projects down to ground state. So we are not going to talk about boundary condition here. So we just pass integral this way. So we have some field configuration here, which depends on this x direction. And what precisely here I mean is that we can take overlap between them. And this precisely gives the wave functional, which is just wave function in Schrodinger equation at some time. So maybe we should time here, then we have to also time here. So this is what I mean. Also, we can do the same thing for opposite state bracket. So this case, we can just do the opposite thing. We do pass integral from plus infinity to t equals 0. Just pass integral here. And again, we have phi x here. So now these two guys, the expression, we can actually rewrite this replica trick into some more convenient form. But before that, for example, we can just talk about this overlap. This should be normalized to be 1. But this is just gives some pass integral. We can just paste to each other. Right? We contract this index. That means we pass integral over all possible phi x, assuming these two phi x are the same. And then we have some pass integral over plus infinity. Minus infinity to plus infinity, plus integral. So that is, very, gives some partition function. So, but we want to disnormalize this to be 1, right? So then we have to mod out by factor of partition function. So if we admit that, we have to, you know, multiply root square root of z here, and also here, more precisely. So then we find this divided by z, and it becomes 1. Okay, so now we'd like to evaluate this reduced density matrix. So this is the first thing we have to do to calculate this one. This is anyway trace of something, so it looks like partition function. So we'd like to represent this trace in terms of some partition function, some manifold. That is the goal of this procedure. So we have trace over, so this is a already we explain. So some ground state wave function and we trace region B. And so this is actually very simple if we admit this representation. So trace out region B means that we partially groove with each other. Here we completely groove with each other. But here we do this only partially. So the result is actually simple that this is a t equal plus infinity like here. I just go this way. So here, so we have this another one, which is t minus infinity at t equals 0. And so we call this region B, we call this region B is here. So we just write it. So we combine this way, but we have some open cut here. So here I mean that so this region is A. The other part, this region and this region is B. This is my we assume here. And so we paste to each other for region B this way and this way. and just do path integral over all geometry. That means we trace out this view freedom. But this region A is opens up, and we have some degree of freedom remains there. So we have to specify something there. So for example, here we have phi alpha and phi, we can just call phi beta, something. So this 2 degree of freedom, which is a boundary condition on this cut, is actually in this argument of this matrix, this phi alpha and phi beta here. So if we specify boundary condition, then you find one reduced density matrix. But of course, this index is quite infinite and it's very complicated to compute in general. OK, so now we are almost done for this calculation. So we, in the end, we compute press law AN's power. Right? So this is just a combination of these. So we have so one path integral with this cut is here. But we have n of that. We have multiply n of this kind of seed. So we have n seed here. And what we'd like to do is to identify between them. So we identify. So this is a matrix. So we have the contract index, right, as usual, and a beta gamma. So we have to contract this index. So we contract this with this one, this way, and the other one with the other one here. Another one here, and some one here. And in the end, this final one, we have to paste with each other here. So in this way, so we get some closed manifold. There are no boundary, except infinity, I just forget about it. That's all here, there are no boundary. So we get some partition function on a manifold with n seed. So with some cut. So cut is along this A, subsystem A. So if we go around this cut, then we have first seat, second seat, and inner seat. If we go around from first seat and then go to second seat, and in a spiral way, and eventually we're going back. If we do this n times, then we're going back. So this is a manifold which we have to consider partition function to compute. So we call this is n seated. So the 2D, so it's a Riemann surface. And we write this in sigma n later. So just here I summarize this result. So anyway, we wanted to compute this trace law A to n's power, and this turns out to be the partition function on this manifold, which you call sigma n. But actually, we have to model this out by trivial partition at some standard partition function to n times n's power, because actually here we didn't take into account this part, this 1 over z factor here. And we have to normalize so that trace law A is always 1. So we have to always model out by this partition function. So we get this one anyway. So this is a main consequence. And good thing is actually this is true. So we assume 2D to write up this kind of diagram in a simple way. But we can just easily extend this higher dimension through in any dimension. So this kind of replica calculation can be done in any dimension. But the problem happens after this. So we find some, you know, this entanglement entropy related to some nice partition function, but how to compute this partition function is, this is actually main question from now, and this only can be analytically solved in 2D CFT, and other case it's much more complicated in general. So this can be, as we see, computable in 2D CFT. Okay, so now I'm going to more details of 2D CFT. So at this point, are there any questions? Is this clear? Okay. So now I'd like to concentrate on 2D CFT to compute entropy. Okay, so maybe what I should ask about time. So we slightly started late. 15 minutes is fine. Maybe can I what a little bit? Maybe so 10 minutes or what is what? Talk about that. So before we go on to the general discussion, which probably I will do in next lecture, here I'd just give one example. It's a 2D massless Dirac fermion. This is because you can actually derive the result for generic 2D CFT, but this is somehow instructive example because you can see the problem. Properties of replica fields and so on. So I just wanted to mention it. So we consider massless Dirac fermion. So psi z. So I write it in a 2D CFT language. So it's z and z bar is a coordinate of 2D space-time. Euclidean space. I'm talking Euclidean continuation, so it's R2. And space coordinate is space coordinate. It's described by Z and Z bar. It's a holomorphic combination. It's X plus IY and X minus IY. It's a complex conjugate. Then Dirac fermion has a complex dual freedom, so psi and psi bar for its left mover, which is a depend on z direction and also right moving part. So z bar and psi bar. If we pick up only one, it's a chiral fermion, what we are talking about. No, chiral fermion. And this has a central charge 1 totally. Each gives 1/2 plus 1/2, it becomes c equal 1. And this theory is characterized by OPE, operator product expansion, which is with kite element 1, z and x, w is the position, and it's OPE is like 1 over z minus w, because these two guys have a dimension 1/2, 1/2. And so anyway, so what I'd like to tell you here is that we have n multiple seat. This is one description, that is true, but equivalently, you can rewrite this in terms of a theory just on a single plane, just one single plane. See, here we have some sigma n, a single complex plane. We just call it G1, G2, this region A. And assuming that, so there is some sort of cut, but geometry is just flat space. But we assume that if we go around, there is some monodromy about fields. So anyway, we have n seat and we have one seat. There are some degree of freedom is totally different. So we have to prepare n copy of fields. So phi 2 and
I write it psi, so I just psi 1, psi 2, and psi n.
Here we have just single field psi, which is described here, maybe psi bar, but we have n copy of that. This n copy is replica, replicated copy.
Replicated fields.
So this is equivalent because fermion on one first seat is called psi 1, and second seat is called psi 2, and the final seat is called psi n. And we have the same, if we go around once, then we go to second seat, that means psi 1 goes to psi 2. So we have this monodromy, like psi a goes to psi a plus 1, if we go around this cut. And if we go around another cut, then it's opposite way. So anyway, so we are considering some quantum field theory with this kind of a twisted boundary condition. To make a calculation more familiar, connected with familiar example, we can just take some sort of Fourier transformation. We define psi tilde b as a sum of Fourier, discrete Fourier transformation of this field. Exponential 2 pi I a times b of n and psi a. So psi a is this one, so n replicated field. A runs from 1 to n. After this, maybe we should multiply normalization factor. After this, we find this monodromy, this twisted condition, twisted, you know, behavior, which go, if we go around this boundary. So this twisted behavior goes to diagonal nuts. So it's like 2 pi I b divided by n and psi b tilde this way. So this is a rather familiar twisted boundary condition.
Boundary condition in orbifold theory. So I'm not going to explain orbifold theory, but I'm assuming
you know the orbifold. What is the basic about orbifold theory? And but this is a quite basic theory which describes the Walsh's theory of string theory. And so if you want to get this twist, then we have to consider so-called least twisted sector. Which is written by especially by using bosonization technique. So fermion in 2D chiral, this is we are talking chiral fermion because it's Z, but we have also anti-chiral one. And this is equivalently described by compact boson, which we like this way. This is called bosonization. That's a basic technique to handle 2D CFT. So by using that, so also I should write basic OPE of this size. This is minus log Z minus W. So by using this description, we can just identify this B twisted sector is just 1 over B divided by N phi and ground state. This is just ground state of this boson. And it's just excited by this vertex operator. So if you can just take an OPE between psi Z and B, then you pick up from this 1 over N factor. So you get something like Z to B over N factor. And if we have this, then if we go around this point once, then you get 2 pi I, exponential 2 pi I here, rotation, and then you pick up 2 pi I b over n, which is exactly what we want here. So this precisely gives the correct answer for this twisted sector. So this setup for particular b, so b takes any value from 0 to n, n minus 1, and gives some this n twisted vector. So now I'd like to finish with this calculation. So now I'd like to compute
this entanglement. That means we compute log n, rho x n's. So we have to sum over each
b, each sector b. So here, actually, it is convenient to work with the following assumption. N is somehow odd integer, and b takes minus 2 n minus 1 to n n minus 1 from this region.
If we, n is odd, this is an integer,
and we can assume this b takes this range. Then you can use this expression. But of course, you can stay with the previous one, other range. Anyway, this is b is dn quantity. Then we can slightly modify this expression so that the b state gives the lowest dimensional state, which is the ground state of this sector. But if we literally use this expression, we have to admit this assumption. But there are no, these are just technical thing, and you can just generalize this in generic situation. Yes, one. And anyway, so n phi and z1, and this is a one, this corresponds to one end point here. And we have also in that another twisted vertex operator here. So this is the opposite one. This has opposite sign, this is C2, but with same weight. And we multiply about B. So this is we're going to compute. And in the end of what we find, this is a clear thing. This is very easy to compute. So Z minus Z2, and to some constant, we are not interested in. And B square, So this conformal dimension is B square and square 1/2. So we find, but this is chiral and non-chiral, both contribution comes. So 2b squared divided by n squared. So this power appears. And we sum over b. And this is an elementary calculation, just summing up elementary series. And in the end, what we find is a sum constant times z minus t2 absolute by 1/6, just it only depends on n. 1/6 and n minus 1. So I just use this. So this is now we can easily get the entanglement entropy. So this is the. As already mentioned, the stress law ends and take log and take derivative, aesthetical one. So basically, what we do, we need to take log of this and with minus sign, so that gives 1 over 6 and n, sorry, 1 over, sorry, n, n minus, this inverse, n, so we get 1, 6 and n minus 1. We take derivative, then each one gives one contribution one, which is proportion one. So we get two totally. So we get 1/3 and log of L. But we have to adjust that this constant part so that if we fix L equal coupling, if L equal to UV cut off, then this means that L is just a one single side or less than single side. That means that there are no entanglement entropy. So that requires entanglement entropy should be zero when L equals epsilon. Well, plus some constant, there are some ambiguity here. But anyway, we derive this expected formula of this entanglement entropy. So more generally, probably I will mention in the second picture. We can show for with central charge C, we get this behavior. So here it's a central charge equal 1, so we get 1/3 here. And this is first formed by Holzen, Larsek, and Wilczek. And our derivation is based on the analysis by Carburetor and Cardi using this pass integral formulation. Okay, so I think I will. Exactly. So this is a twist thing, it's a twist operator. So that is localized in one point-like localized object. But in higher dimension, this is like a surface operator. Mm-hmm. And we don't know how to deal with that. Maybe in future, yes, but so far, there are no nice way to do that.
There was one more question. Could you please repeat again your example with the restoration of thermal entropy for the case of when the size of the subsystem goes to zero in the beginning of the lecture?
Yeah, yeah. Repeat? Oh, okay, okay. Yeah, yeah. So it's very simple. Eh? So the claim is just so we assume a Hilbert space is a total Hilbert HA plus HA times HB. This is the starting point. We have some A and B. And we assume A goes to 0, size of A goes to 0. And we take the difference between SB and SA. And we get the summer entropy. And this summer entropy, more precisely, just defined by press rho log rho for total density matrix. Is this clear?
So it does depend on the initial total density matrix, it's universal.
Initial total density, it depends, of course.
No, I mean, by thermal, you mean like just rho log rho, not necessarily e to the beta h.
No. Sorry. I'm assuming that the total density matrix here, for example, like beta H over Z. Assume this. Then this becomes really summer result. So this is what I assume. So, or in more generic case, summer entropy, I just mean this one, total entropy. Sorry, if some confusion, sorry about that.